are now tuned in to Hits 92.3, where we take great pride in personal expression of one's feelings, thoughts, or ideals. What you're getting ready to hear on this show are the opinions of the hosts and their guests, and they do not reflect the opinions of Hits 92.3 radio station, the brand, management, staff, their respective advertisers, parent companies, or affiliates. Now stay tuned as this show begins in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Welcome to Legacy Crypto Builders. I'm your host, Diana Townsend, right here on Hits Radio 92.3. I'm here each and every Wednesday from 12 noon to 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. We're going to dive into the transformative world of blockchains with a purpose. Join us as we explore how today's tech pioneers are building the legacy of tomorrow, one block at a time. Stay tuned. The future of blockchain starts now. Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to Hits 92.3, where the Legacy Crypto Builders are here every Wednesday from 12 to 1. We're talking all things crypto, blockchain, AI, and I have a special video, Mr. I Am Money, Mr. Cliff O'Neal. So I'm super happy to have you here, Cliff.
I'm super happy to be here. How's everything been going?
I decided to show off a little bit today, and it was actually Cliff's idea, too. I was like, two of my favorite people. And I also have on the line, we have Mr. Ricardo, Make It Make Sense, Hamilton. So welcome to the show, Ricardo.
Man, fired up and excited as always to be here. Good morning, good afternoon, everybody. Good to see you guys. What's going on, Brother Cliff?
Not too much. How you doing, brother?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Fired up and excited, man. Fired up and excited.
Ricardo, why we got to do this all the time? What's your cue? What you supposed to be doing?
Oh! Let me start the show off right. Okay, I apologize.
We do this all the time.
Apologize. Look, class is in session. That's that real money clap. Class is in session. Look, what a phenomenal time to be alive. To be able to, you know, build wealth and assets and benefit from the largest wealth transfer in history, and that's why, you know, shows like this are so important. So we can help get this message out, because a lot of people, you know, they just don't know what they don't know. And the only way they're going to find out is if somebody tells them. And that's why we're here, to kind of let you know what's going on with the monetary system and how you can benefit and get ahead, you know, with digital and physical assets. So, yeah, let's get this show started.
All right. So we're going to start off with I Am Money, Mr. Cliff O'Neal. So, Cliff, I asked you, I said, what should we name the show? And you said, what was the title?
So the title was don't. Let me see. Because I had like
how to be
hyperinflation. Yes. I thought about it like for like 30 minutes. Remember, I kept seeing you like different titles, right? So I call it, really honestly, it's really about closing the wealth gap, but how to beat the hyperinflated market that's right now, you know, getting larger and larger and larger. A lot of people don't know this, but we're actively in a recession right now. I've been in a recession since 2021. You know, I know they're just now starting to come out saying that we're in a recession. No, we've been in a recession since 2021. So now we're getting ready to go towards the lane of hyperinflation versus being in a resuscitative meta. You're going into a hyperinflated market, a more depression type market. I've seen a quote that really, really bothered me. And it said that we're in a Hunger Games society. A Hunger Games type of society. How do you feel about this thing?
For me, just thinking about what Hunger Games is, that's sad. Mm-hmm. That's scary that they would even classify us like that. What about you, Ricardo? How you feel about that?
Yeah, no, I mean, I would agree. You know, the poor and the middle class are going to continue to get wiped out. As, you know, like Cliff talked about, the hyperinflation, as the dollar continues to lose value. And it's because, you know, people lack financial literacy and understanding of how the monetary system works. You know, they're going to continue to suffer, and we're going to continue to see wealth, you know, continue to rise for the 1%, because they're in assets, and the poor and the middle class continue to get, you know, wiped out and devastated, you know. And so I agree 100%. This is a, you know, this is a Hunger Games type of society that we're in right now. And that's why we're trying to, you know, let people know where this is going, because there's an opportunity for you to, you know, change your life, you know, change the course of the trajectory for you and your family forever if you do the right things. But that window of opportunity is closing very fast, because once this reset really takes off, you know, you might not have the option to be able to get the assets. You know, you might be priced out. You know, it's not going to be this way forever. So, yeah, I agree with the brother 100%.
Yeah, we also have to talk about the current status of where we are now, you know, and look at what has happened and transpired from this point to where we are right now previously to a point to where, let's say, we were in the 90s. Let's talk about how, let me ask you guys a question about this. What was that the median house income without going to Google? What was the median house income for a family for 1996?
If I guess, I'll say like about $75,000.
Very close. Very close. $71,000 annually. What's the median household income for a family for to live comfortably today? First off, before you even answer that, what is the number one goal that most people want to ascend to financially annually?
We're really just trying to keep a roof over our head and take care of our families. But I did, I was looking into that because I'm kind of shifting a little bit to learn, thanks to Ricardo getting on me all the time, talking about how I'm over leveraged. And I just be so tunnel focused into my platform when he was like, you got to stay woke. You got to open, you know, you got to be a little bit more open. And then here you come. Clip saying, you know, like, look at the market, look at all these other tokens, look at this, look at that. You both were saying the same thing at different times to me, that sometimes, you know, you just as a person, whether you see it or not, when two phenomenal people are sharing something with you, you have to take that into consideration because it was the same subject, just a different day. But to me, I feel like with that number, if I had to guess, I would probably say maybe over $200,000. It has to be.
Absolutely. But the number one goal that most people want to ascend to in life has always been $100,000. $100,000 is upper, lower class.
It used to be where we wanted to get to, yeah. Because you had so much extra. There's no extra now. You're just barely making it.
In a medium income household for a family of four to live comfortably, now it's $277,000 annually. So look at how far that's grown from 1996 to 2024.
And the wages doesn't complement it. Everything's going up except for our wages.
Absolutely. So you got to kind of measure things on that type of spectrum to see where we came from into where we are right now today versus what the potential is for the near future. Because the near future is coming right now. Like my brother said, we're in the greatest transformation of wealth in human history right now. Right. And 98.9% of the people who are living right now, living, breathing beings in this great transformation will not be able to capitalize on the transformation.
Ricardo, you want to elaborate on that a little bit? Because I hear you talk about that all the time.
Yeah. What most people understand is that AI, robotics, automation is replacing your job. They no longer need you. In fact, people right now are training AI models and don't even realize it. That they're training their replacement. And, you know, during the industrial era, they needed human labor. They needed you to physically work in the factories, in the fields. They needed you to do stuff. They needed humans. Today, they no longer need us. You know, they have the AI, they have the robotics, and that's the problem that they're having. They're ready to implement this new society, this technological revolution that's taking place. And, but they're trying to figure out what they're gonna do with the people. So now they're talking about implementing UBI, you know, universal basic income, or, you know, all these different type of measures to try to satisfy this problem, which to them is us, to them, we're the problem, right? But really they're the problem. But you just have to realize that the world has changed forever because of technology, because of AI, because of robotics. The job market is not gonna be the same. You have to innovate. You have to do something different. You have to get outside your bubble. But if you do the right things with your money right now, you could put yourself in a position where you don't have to worry about a job, you know, where you don't have to worry. Your assets can be working for you. You can put your assets to work for you, either in, you know, we talk about with blockchain, either staking them or putting up for yield, you know, using your assets as collateral. You know, it's a whole new economy, but you have to just follow the right people. Okay, get the right information, right, and acquire the right assets, and you could change your life forever. But unfortunately, because people aren't aware of what's going on, they don't understand just how rapidly AI is getting ready to take over everything. I mean, every industry, you know, driving. I was in Phoenix, Arizona. They got the Uber vehicle and no drivers there. It was all, you know, yeah. I mean, there was nobody behind.
I've never heard that.
Yeah.
That's crazy. Yeah, are you serious?
Yeah, absolutely. And to expand on what my brother is saying, to get for the people in the back who really didn't hear what he was saying, they're basically getting ready to put everybody on government assistance.
Let's talk about that. Say it again.
What my brother just said is they're basically getting ready to put everybody on government assistance. For the people who frown upon government assistance, you're getting ready to take your butt on government assistance by default. When it comes down to AI, let me break this down and put this into higher perspective for you. By the year 2028, they're expecting over 100 million jobs to be lost to AI. Over 100 million jobs. There are only 128 million full-time jobs in America.
How many?
128 million.
So only 28 million people are going to be employed?
Think about that. That's over 80% of the job market.
That's crazy.
That will be replaced by AI tech in the next 3.5 years.
Mm-hmm.
You're going on government assistance.
Don't say you're going on government assistance.
That's what's happening. If you're not in a position to capitalize on the greatest transformation of wealth, you're going to be enslaved by the greatest transformation of wealth.
Wait a minute. Hold on. Let me say, Ricardo, you said, you're going to go on UBI. You are so professional. Cliff says, you're going on government assistance.
Yeah.
It's not funny, though, because it's scary. That goes back to what you started out the whole conversation. If somebody even puts us in the, you got to go back and think about what the Hunger Games was about and how those people was doing what they had to do to survive, but slowly but surely they was falling off. Everybody was, you know, everybody's not going to survive. And it's sad because we're all three of us are in a industry where we're the minority. The majority don't even agree with it, don't believe in it. But it is a possibility that crypto, blockchain, AI, what we do could save all everybody's life. And they're not even open to it.
You know what's crazy? And I like to use this analogy when I want to really get people to fully understand what's happening. Imagine going back, and I want everybody that's listening, you guys to listen. Imagine going back to 1996. 1996 was a very, very golden era. But imagine someone telling you in 1996 that you can buy a t-shirt, buy a pair of shoes, buy something on the internet with a debit card. You would have cussed that person out. I'm not putting my debit card on this computer. What are you talking about? That's the foolish thing in the world. I'm not putting my debit card on this computer. 1996, that was the mindset of the average person. But the people who are in the computer age, that computer programming age, they knew where we were heading in the future. Therefore, they prepared and advanced and invested in the future. They invested into Google. They invested into means that of that make. They invested into Microsoft. And those people who invested back then, when everyone was saying, I'm not doing that, I'm not doing this, are now the billionaires and trillionaires of the world. So, in the blockchain space, and not even just in the blockchain space, in the investment space in general, especially dealing with cross-border transactional currencies, like blockchain-based currencies, cryptocurrencies, like precious metals, gold, silver, God's money, like international real estate, anybody who's investing into these categories right now, you will be the next world millionaires and billionaires because you're getting in the 1996 era of the greatest transformation of wealth in human history.
Yes, Ricardo, can you elaborate on that?
Well, yeah, while he was saying that, it made me come right back to what he said earlier about hyperinflation. You know, if you really understand that the dollar is going to continue to lose value, it's going to continue to lose its credibility and status globally. And if you understand that, what that means is that assets are going to continue to rise in value. And that if you have those assets now, you know, you're going to benefit from that hyperinflation. But if you don't have those assets, you're going to get crushed. You're going to get wiped out because you're holding on to dollars. And this is why, you know, we also always talk about, you know, precious metals, God's money, physical silver and gold, because these are and have been known and always as how you preserve your wealth. You know, there is zero third party counter risk when it comes to silver and gold. You know, that like Cliff mentioned earlier, he just said it's God's money. That's your third party. I got faith in God. I got faith in God's money, right? But, you know, everything else has third party counter risk. You know, even when it comes to the monetary standard right now, that's set up by the Bank of International Settlements, which is the central bank for central banks, right? Their gold is a tier one asset. And so what that means is that it has zero risk associated to it. Gold and silver will always have value, you know, and in the times that we're in right now, this hyperinflationary environment, you know, global war, pandemics and things of this nature, gold and silver has seen it all. There's nothing new that has happened on the planet, you know, where gold and silver have not had value. You know, it's been money since the times of Egypt. You know, it's money in Africa, Asia, Europe, the Americas. Here in the United States, it's real money, constitutional money, Article 1, Section 10 of the U.S. Constitution. There's about 12 states or so in the United States where you can spend gold and silver the same way you spend cash. It's real money. So this is one of the best ways to hedge and diversify on a physical sense. You see, we talk about the digital side. That's on a digital sense of hedging and diversifying. But on a physical sense, you know, physical silver and gold is how you preserve your wealth and how you're going to grow your wealth, especially right now, because they've been rigging and manipulating this market for decades. JP Morgan and their traders have went to jail. They have been fined millions of dollars for rigging and manipulating the precious metals market. And the reason they do that is because they don't want you to get real assets. They don't want you to have real money. They don't want you to have real value, because right now JP Morgan is sitting on over 800 million ounces of physical silver. So while they're shorting and manipulating the market, they're actually buying up the assets, right? Because they want you in the system. They want to make it easier for them to confiscate your wealth. And they can easily do that when you have a digital illusion of wealth that's tied into the market, where they can implement all type of margin calls, market crashes, and everything else that take place, like we saw in 2008. And most people don't realize we're in a worse position than we were in 2008. If you remember 2008, if you thought 2008 was bad, I want you to imagine that 10 times worse. And we might even say 100 times worse, because I think there is no bailing this out. I don't think there is any coming out of this. This is a whole new reset. I think we're going to see derivatives market crash. We're going to see the bond market crash. We're seeing it right now, where the Federal Reserve has to step in and print money to buy the bonds, to reduce the rates, because the world is dumping treasuries and they're buying gold. Right now, central banks are buying more gold than they ever have at any time period in history. So, I mean, you know, we're right on point. I mean, we're giving people the pertinent information of today, and we're providing them with the systems and solutions to get ahead. But, you know, like that old saying, they say you can lead the camel to the water, but you can't make them drink it, you know, and it's applied knowledge that's power. You know, and that's what we want you to do. We want you to apply this knowledge that we're giving to you.
Oh, that was a good one, that to take us right into break, Ricardo. We're going to go to a commercial break, and then we're going to come right back, and we're going to talk about it.
Calling all future content creators, Digital Media Masters is hosting a hands-on podcasting workshop just for teens aged 13 to 17. Unleash your main character energy and learn to create engaging podcasts with StreamYard on your Android or iPhone every Saturday from 12 noon to 3 p.m. at Hits 92.3. But act fast, as only 4 slots are available per workshop. Sign up today at digitalmediamastersga.com. It's your moment to shine. That's digitalmediamastersga.com. Experience the taste of excellence with Queen and Slim's Kitchen. We cater events, private parties, corporate gatherings, and more. Book now by texting 757-729-0244 or visit at Queen and Slim's Kitchen on Instagram to make your next event unforgettable.
Thank you guys for joining us here each and every Wednesday from 12 to 1, where we're talking all things blockchain, cryptocurrency, AI. In the studio, I have Crypto Cliff, and joining us online, we have Mr. Ricardo Make It Make Sense Hamilton, and we're here talking about how we can beat inflation. So let's pick up where we kind of left off at. When we went off air, I said to Cliff, I said, I cannot believe, because honestly, a lot of times they are always pouring into me. They know way more about this market than what I do. And I'm so thankful and grateful for the relationship, because we're like-minded. And that's who you got to surround yourself with, because to me, they always tell us we're the product of the closest five people to you. And I'm so thankful and grateful for the relationship to having these two, because, and they're in two completely, like Ricardo absolutely loves gold and silver, but Cliff is like trading like in his sleep. And for me, I am absolutely in love with the node. There's so many different lanes that you can be in out here in this space. And I think all three of us, if I could, you correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm like, we all love what we do. I don't think we like it. I think we love what we do because it's just in our DNA, and we were probably put on this earth to do that. So let's pick back up where we left off at, Cliff, because I'm still over here. I just want to write. I want to listen. I want y'all to tell me some more stuff, because I am still stuck on where we are. I mean, we didn't even touch base yet on the rates that are, what is that, the September 15th, like in a week or so, or the 16th? We're supposed to find out if they're going to cut the rates. To me, my personal opinion is I don't think they have any other choice based off where we are right now. But what's your take on that?
Look, before we get into the race, I got to kind of give everybody a gut punch. Right. And brother Ricardo, he said something that was very, very valid, talking about the bonds and how they're cutting down, you know, having to print more money to kind of lower the rates of the bonds. Guess who's buying all those bonds?
The banks.
China and Russia.
Oh, Lord. They're buying. Did you know that, Ricardo?
I know that the Federal Reserve is buying the bonds when they cut rates, because they got to get in the market to buy them. I know that governments around the world are buying less of our bonds. But of course, they're still, you know, the dollars, let's put it like this. The dollar's not going anywhere overnight. Okay. The dollar's going to be here. Okay. It's just that what's the purchasing power of the dollar? You know, that's what it's really going to come down to. But yes, you know, governments around the world and central banks, of course, they're still buying bonds. I'm under the impression they're buying less than what they obviously were previously buying, and they're buying more gold. But yeah, I mean, the Federal Reserve, when they say, the big picture is, when the Federal Reserve says that we're cutting rates, there isn't a magic button that they press and rates just automatically go to whatever they say it is. They actually have to physically get into the market, print value from nothing, buy those bonds to reduce the rate, which is an inflationary event. And then the banks now have the ability to borrow, they make money cheap, right? So they can borrow money, and then you just inflate the bubble again. You know, they're going to buy back their stocks. You know, you're going to see a bubble on real estate and whatnot. But the problem is that, you know, you have a domestic responsibility with the money, and then you have an international, you know, responsibility with the money. And what we're going to see overseas is a hastening in the dumping of the dollar and the treasuries as they continue to dilute and devalue the currency. So I think we'll see a short-term pump, but I think we're eventually going to see the major crash right after.
It's about to pop at any moment right now.
I was going to say, what's the time frame?
You're talking about, we don't know. You're talking about 37.5 trillion in debt right now, right? And that's just the debt that they tell us about. The true debt is way higher. You know, so that bubble has the potential to pop at any time, and with them dumping more inflated dollars into the markets.
Yeah. I put a post up on my Facebook that showed, here's 2008, and they showed a chart, a bar graph, and it showed unrealized losses. And, the bar was like this big in 2008. And then it fast forwarded to 2024, and it showed unrealized losses, and the bar was about like this big. And so it's like, you know, what are we really in? You know, people really just don't have any idea how big and how hard this collapse is going to be. But it's going to be something that's talked about for generations to come, for millennium. The time period that we're living in right now will be studied for centuries, okay, and talked about for centuries. That's why I say we're living in the most significant time period ever in history.
I honestly believe, not to get too political, but whoever wins the next presidential election will go down as the worst economy, the worst leader.
Yeah. So what he's adopting, like you walking into that, he or she, you're walking into that. It's crazy. I don't know.
They will go down as the worst economic leader in U.S. history. So be careful who you vote for.
I was talking about that to somebody as well yesterday, where it really doesn't matter who's in. The crash is happening. The reset is happening. The monetary system is broken. They're tokenizing everything. Everything is moving to the blockchain. We're going to return back to gold as money, okay, and silver as money. That's why BRICS, Brazil, Russia, India, China, South Africa, even Zimbabwe back their currency by gold. The CBDCs are going to be backed by gold. They'll use a ledger to be able to conduct international trade and commerce that they trust. But there's always going to be some underlying resources in the real world to back up the value of their particular CBDC. But it's all going to come down to, the assets, but this system is going to crash regardless. It's resetting. That's it. And when you reset something, it shuts down and then builds back up. So it's just like if you ever looked at The Economist magazine, if you ever Google it, and I think it's the 1988 edition, and it said, "Are you ready for a new world currency?" I think that's what it was, new world currency. But they had a phoenix bird rising out of the ashes of paper money. So you had the dollar, you had the yen, you had the euro, and it's on fire. And this phoenix bird rising out of it, and the phoenix bird had a gold chain on with a and it had like a digital zero, almost looked like XLM symbol or something. But it was like, it's showing that out of the crash of this paper debt fiat based monetary system, out of it's going to rise a new monetary system that's going to be based off of physical and digital assets.
Yeah. Blockchain technology.
Yeah.
And with that being said, and I actually seen that article, I seen that magazine a while ago. But yeah, that was the confirmation from the elites of the next world transformation, which, like you said, is going to be the tokenization of real world assets.
Yeah,
and that tokenization is going to be done everything through my view, blockchain technology and quantum computing.
Yep. And one thing about that is when I think about it, you understand that these people, when they get to their Bilderberg groups, their Council on Foreign Relations, their World Economic groups, their trilateral commissions, they plan stuff out 30, 40, 50 years ahead of time. They already see where this is going. So while they got everybody else on the day-to-day, just trying to survive, when they get together, they're not thinking about the things that you're thinking about. They're thinking about future. They're 10 years, 20 years, they got plans and trajectories. So it is, ripe in that timing where we're talking about, 1988, they said, get ready for a new world currency. And here we are, 50, coming up on 50 years later or whatever it is, that's happening.
Absolutely. We're going to say 37 years, because he's going to make me sound old. I was born in 85.
90, 40, yeah, something like that. Almost 40 years. But yeah.
Almost 40 years. Don't age me, bro. Don't age me.
Hey, well, look, they got the technology now, brother, where we're going to live longer. I'm telling you, people are going to live to about 150, 200 years now because of the science and advancement and being.
What are you talking about?
Oh, yeah, they can literally put your consciousness into computer systems.
Not even just that. Your ability to heal yourself on a cellular level, that the science is coming out now. That's why I say know thyself. When you understand your body on a cellular level, right, and how you can heal thyself. The science and stuff that's coming out today is far beyond what people really realize, and the ability for longevity of life.
Absolutely.
Is really huge. Yeah.
Especially when you talk about human growth hormone. I've been really, really looking into it heavy, and how you can pretty much regenerate every single bit of your body and age yourself back at least 30, 40 years.
Yep. Yeah, they have the science now. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, some people made a comment that they saw Oprah. I don't know where they saw Oprah was, but Oprah looking younger than she looked back in the day. That's what I was
they
like.
Stay on Oprah, though, yeah, and she seems to be experimental. So hold on, you guys. Let me look at some of these comments. Mr. XRP All In, first of all, he said, good afternoon to you guys. And he said, all you need is XRP. Maybe a couple coins, but XRP should be your biggest bag. What's your take on that?
I completely disagree.
Disagree?
I completely disagree.
Wait a minute. Okay, hold on. What's your take on it, Ricardo?
Yeah, you should never put all your eggs in one basket. You know, I mean, I think everybody's heard that before. You should never put all your eggs in one basket. You know, and I don't want to have a cult mentality with anything. And you never want to be really a maxi. Like there's people who, some people say you only need Bitcoin. You know, some people say you only need XRP, you know, and some people say you only need gold and silver. You know, I don't see what stops somebody from diversifying into all three or others. You know what I mean? I mean, you don't want to have yourself spread too thin, but have your core three, four, five, you know, whatever it is that you are dollar cost averaging in, that you're hedging in and, you know, preserving your dollars with. But I'm a big believer in XRP and ISO tokens, obviously. And I'm a big believer in physical silver and gold. I think, you know, long as you're converting your dollars into assets and not holding dollars, you'll be winning.
So let me come back to you, Cliff. Why do you disagree? Because like I got a number, and just to put my number out there, I have on my vision board, it says my goal is to have 10,000 XRP. Mm-hmm. But so I kind of agreed with Mr. All In. I was thinking, like, I'm not saying, I definitely am not putting all my eggs in that basket, but I'm a big believer in XRP. So why did you say no? Tell me that.
I'm a huge believer in XRP as well. And I got to agree with my brother. You always want to diversify. You always want to have your bags in different sectors. You don't want to have everything sitting in XRP. You don't want to have everything sitting in just ISO tokens. You want to have a well-rounded portfolio. And I have the system proven, the portfolio that has been proven to show you what a well-rounded investment portfolio can really, really do for you. Case in point. Now, if I had to say, I want to put my all into one crypto asset, it would be Bitcoin. Point blank, period. Here's why. I've been in the cryptocurrency space since 2011. I am up right now 58,000% on my first Bitcoin holdings. Bitcoin is also the most deflationary asset in human history. It's outworked gold, it's outworked silver, it's outworked every single tech sector on the planet. Bitcoin is also the only cryptocurrency on the planet that can be transferred and sent out without internet connection. So it has different features and factors that other crypto assets don't have. But you always want to have a very well-rounded investment portfolio. Don't just put all your eggs in XRP. All right. I would say if you're going to go that route, just buy into ISO tokens. Buy into ISO tokens. XRP, XLM, XDC, IOTA, HBAR, Algorand. Buy into those type of tokens. But at least you will have a well-rounded bag. And some level twos, including with the ISO tokens.
Do me a favor and repeat those again for people. Because I know for me, like, I love taking notes. I'll go back and I'll write some things down. No, none of us are financial advisors. We're just kind of sharing our opinion here. And especially for new people that are in the space and might not be sure, do your own due diligence. But some of those tokens that Cliff are talking about, like, they're really phenomenal in the space. So can you repeat them for me?
XRP, XLM, XDC, IOTA, HBAR, Algorand. I would even go as far as his Casper as well, too. Also Quant. Quant has probably one of the biggest networks, even bigger, actually even larger than XRP, to be honest.
Okay. Ricardo, you know you are a gold and silver man, but I also know that you have a diversified portfolio. You mind sharing with us some of your favorite tokens?
Yeah, and one of the things about you know, XRP, like Cliff mentioned too, is that also, you know, without internet connection, it can be transmitted. So I agree with, you know, like I said, we are believers in XRP, but, like, you know, obviously diversify. And he mentioned ISO tokens. I would just say, like, you know, when you're looking at the blockchain space, you want to find projects that are providing solutions in the real world economy. And, you know, there's a lot of different projects out there, and you want to get into the categories where you're excited about, that you believe in, that you're passionate about, because if you don't keep up to date with your investments, you know, that's pointless. You want to know what's going on in that industry. You want to know what's going on with that project, you know. So there's different segments, you know, of the blockchain space. You know, I'm seeing whether it's, you know, metaverse, you know, NFT projects, yield, you know, projects, or DeFi projects. You know, there's so many different things, just like in the stock market. You know, there's just different segments of the economy, different segments of the stock market you can get into, and you would want to have a diversified portfolio in stocks. Well, it's the same thing with your blockchain portfolio. You want to have a diversified asset in that as well. And so that's why, you know, great tools and resources like CoinMarketCap is phenomenal to be able to see these projects, see these different categories, see which ones are the top trending projects, you know, and do your further due diligence. But you know, gaming is going to be huge. Obviously, when the bull run takes off, you know, obviously when Bitcoin rises, you know, they say, you know, when the tide rises, all the boats rise with it. You know, when Bitcoin rises, you know, all the other projects, you know, essentially rise in value as well. So, you know, yeah, you just want to have a diversified portfolio, you know, in different segments, you know, that you find that you like. So I'm big on ISO, obviously Bitcoin, Ethereum, I like Polkadot. You know, you can't really go wrong. I like Casper too, like Casper as well. You know, there's a lot of different projects, you know, in different segments that I diversify in. Sometimes most of them I do it on an automatic reoccurring buy. You can just set it up to where even $25 a week, you just get on a consistent basis, have it coming on a consistent basis and dollar cost average in. So
yeah. Basically, with everything we're talking about today, the other day on my Facebook page, I want to say it was the first. I woke up and I said, hey, you guys, anybody, like, crypto has been so amazing to me. Anybody that's willing to set up a free account, I'm going to give you, it's free. It doesn't cost you anything. It's free 99. I'm going to give you like 5,000 rewards for free. I want to say maybe, what's today? The 4th? I think today's the 4th. Maybe 3 people hit me up. One of the young ladies on my team, she told me today, she said, how about nobody responded? She said, I liked your post and I decided to repost it. And because we talked about just giving away the crypto. Because sometimes, you know, we tend to live in Missouri and people want to see what it does and see this and see that and the other. And she told me, she posted it the same day and not one person, not one of her Facebook friends hit her up. And it wasn't costing them anything. You have no idea what that crypto could, if anything, or would ever do anything. But the mindset of people, I don't think they realize, even me, I'm in the space. I did not know. I'm telling you, whenever I had these conversations with these two gentlemen, I always find myself being in a wow factor. Like, what? Like, because I'm telling you, when we went to break, I was like, Cliff, what are you talking about? 100 million jobs are going to be gone. Then when I think Ricardo, I really believe Ricardo was the person that probably shook me up and was like, you got to get out of being so closed-minded. You got to open up that portfolio. You are so stuck. You're over-leveraged in this company. And you got to understand there's so much more happening out here. And then I run into Cliff and it was like, same story, different day. And it's really sad that the world is in this situation, the Hunger Games. I don't like that either. That's terrible for somebody to, was that like a person on Facebook or was that like a person in the industry saying that?
Oh, that was one of the top influencers of all time.
Oh my God.
You're talking one of the top investors of all time. Then Warren Buffett came right behind him and said it as well.
That's crazy.
Oh yeah, and they're talking about how the real estate market is getting recrashed. Everything around us is getting ready to be demolished. And it needs to be demolished, to be honest, for us to have this reset to actually happen. Because from those ashes will be the next transformation for it. And it's going to a tokenized system. Gold is getting ready to be tokenized. The real estate market is getting ready to be tokenized. If you don't look for anything else, start looking into crypto DAOs. If you look at what a crypto DAO really, really is, it will explain exactly how all of these asset classes will be tokenized. The stock market will be tokenized. Everything is going to the tokenization of assets. Partial ownership of certain things. Even Larry Fink, the CEO of the largest investment corporation on the planet, came out and said that every real world asset will be tokenized by 2030.
You know, a lot of, you know, I was going to say, you know, to Diana's point, when it comes to our people and, you know, trying to help people out and you can offer something for free and they don't take advantage of it. And when I think about that, I think about, you know, why our people, you know, in thinking that way or not taking action. And it always comes down like the food you're eating and the water we're drinking. I mean, even right now, the EPA came out and said that there's no safe levels of fluoride in the body. But yet they put fluoride in your toothpaste. It's in your water. And what it does is calcify your pineal gland. And what that does is affects your ability to fight or flight. You know, it affects your ability to think. And so a lot of people just don't really know how to think and they don't know, you know, what to do. And then even if you tell some people what to do, a lot of our people suffer from cognitive dissonance. You know, they're just used to things being a certain way and they're not receptive to new information and doing things differently. You know, but No, unfortunately, some people are in that position, and then fortunately, some people are waking up, you know, and realizing that, you know, they have to do something different. But yes, unfortunate when you have people and you want to help them and they don't even want to help themselves.
I think our people are stuck in a state of self-sabotage. Mm. Point blank, period. We self-sabotage ourselves with a lot of things. And most of us are too comfortable being uncomfortably comfortable.
Wait. Ricardo did this to me last week and I got the giggles. I couldn't get myself together. Say that again.
Most people are self-sabotaging themselves. And they're too comfortable being uncomfortably comfortable, meaning that instead of them going and thinking a certain way and saying, okay, even when you have the evidence in front of your face, and I use my family as a guide to this as well, because my family seen me make the millions. They seen the vacations. I'm in 29 countries. They seen the houses I built. They seen the cars I had built from ground up. They seen the wealth. And when I offered to teach my entire family for free, they told me no.
That's crazy.
They seen it.
Now, I could see if they hadn't seen it. So does that mean, because, you know, sometimes they say people want things for free. They don't want you to teach them. They just want you to give them things.
They don't want things for free. They don't want things for free. How long have I been on Facebook for years teaching the same thing? And all of my Facebook friends, before my old page got shut down, they seen the wealth. They seen the money. They seen the investments. They seen the vacations. They seen the cars. They seen the houses. They're too comfortable being uncomfortably comfortable, because it takes more effort for you to say, I am effed up and I need to get here, than to just stay in that same state, because they're comfortable in that same state. They can recognize themselves in that same state. And that's just not financially. That's mentally. That's spiritually. That's emotionally.
That's crazy.
If you're getting validation behind you being depressed, you're not going to get out of that depressive moment. Because it takes work for you to get out of that depressive moment. But you're getting validation by being depressed.
We've had these conversations with Ricardo. You want to elaborate on that?
On people just, you know, being stuck in their ways and being depressed. Or what you said.
That's just an analogy to speak on, you know?
I'm just saying, yeah. Like, we've had those conversations as far as family is concerned, because I'm in that same situation. And I'm like, I don't get it. I don't understand. Like, a complete stranger will be open to learn. They'll be transparent sometimes. And they'll say, listen, I need to figure something out because the math is not mathing.
Right.
And I'm just looking. I'm open. And, you know, like sometimes spirits align and mm-hmm. they'll say, I could relate to some of the things that you've been through. Or I don't even think people wake up and say, you know, I want to be rich today. You just need to keep the roof over your head. How are we going to, if you can barely make it with a job, how are people going to make with this UBI? Like, how are you, I might have been on one of YouTube's pages. It said, might be you, Cliff. You said 10 million people did not pay their rent or mortgage in June. I think 12.5 didn't pay the rent and mortgage in July, and I haven't seen in August. Did you see the stats for August? And I'm like, it's constantly going up and up and up. It's not getting any better. So I don't understand how people did not just wake up and say, I got to do something different. I got to be open. I got to figure it out, because you can't go out and get another job, because all the jobs are heading towards AI. It's hard to get a job out here. I be reading all the time where people be like, I put in all these resumes. I've been looking every day. Nobody's calling me back. The jobs are just not there like they used to be.
Yeah. And they're lying about the jobs numbers. They just had to come out and say that, you know, 800,000 plus jobs that they said existed didn't exist. And, you know, they based monetary policy on that. The situation is way worse than people really realize. But yeah, unfortunately, it's never like your friends and your family that support you or, like, you know, get behind you. It's always like strangers, you know, somebody online who, you know, who follow you. And, you know, even my own self, you know, my success that I've had over the last few years, it didn't come from friends and family and, you know, people who I've known for X amount of years. It came from, you know, strangers, essentially, you know, who became, you know, great friends and exactly. Who became like family. You know what I mean? And so it's a family outside the family. But yeah, it's crazy how that works, you know. You know, and obviously it's it's just something that it's a thing. You know, it is what it is. I mean, if you see Cliff, like you said, he's houses, cars, traveling. And, you know, if I was Cliff's relative, I'd be plugging in with, you know, Cliff, you know, 24/7, you know, and trying to imitate and do exactly what he's doing because he has a system of success, you know. But, you know, like I said, you know, what do you attribute people's inability to take action and change their lives? You know, the normalcy bias, the complacency bias, you know, most people need to understand that nobody's coming to save you. You know, I think that people are waiting for, you know, the government to save them. They're waiting for, you know, somebody to come save them, you know, Obama or somebody. They're waiting for somebody to come save them. Nobody's coming to come save you. You got to save yourself. The information, the opportunities, the access to the resources, we've never been in this position before. They didn't even want us to read and write. Information is at our fingertips right now. Access to whatever it is that we want to be able to do. Nothing is inhibiting us from becoming who we've always imagined ourselves to be. We are the masters of our own fate and destiny. But, you know, and they know that, and they knew this time was coming. And that's why you see, I mean, look in California right now, they're trying to get the reparations bill passed, you know, and you know, even our own people, you know, stopping them from being able to just bring the bill to the floor. But yet they're giving this money away to illegals. So it's obvious who is for us and who is against us, but you know, it's hard for people to shake their ways and stand up and fight and really, you know, demand change and really start to do the things that are going to change their lives. And, you know, I think that's from a deliberate dumbing down of the masses through the education system and the polluting of the mind and body through the food and water. And this has been something that's, and then of course, with drugs as well in our communities. You know, we have a lot of issues that we're still trying to overcome. Post-traumatic slave disorder and things of that nature. So it's easy for on one side to say, can't you see, just do this. But there's a lot of things, you know, behind that. But, you know, we got to just keep, you know, being an example, you know, being a light, showing people the way. And for those who, you know, who have eyes to see, for those who have ears to hear, you know, they're going to go on this journey and do what they're supposed to do. But unfortunately, we won't be able to save everybody.
Look, let me respond to one of the listeners, Mr. D. Jackson. He says that, and it's true, and it's a little bit of what you just said too, Ricardo. He said, you could just take $5 and buy some XLM instead of buying some cigarettes, weed, and some liquor. It's priorities, it's mindset, because there's, not to go all, we don't have that much time left, but to go all into it, it's really sad that this younger generation is so addicted to weed. And just where their mindset is, it's like they have to have it. But what if they had to have, you know, investments or was open to crypto? Because it does not take a lot. It takes a little bit of, you know, it's like the compound effect. That's why I always say it takes a little bit of activity to keep doing the same thing to get a better result. So for me, I'm just like, you go out here and you're dedicated. Like, I have to have, you know, this marijuana. I don't know what's going on with it, but it just seems like they're not going to live without it. But yet, you could have taken that same money and bought, as he said, a little bit of XLM, a little bit of XRP, there's some tokens, there's some Shiba, there's a whole bunch of stuff out there that you could have done to be able to see how you could have spent that money or potentially put yourself in a better situation. You know, did a little bit of research and see if you can relate. You usually always talk about VeChain. You ain't saying nothing about VeChain today.
VeChain is one of them, but I have a little radical. I'm a little radical when it comes down to that. Because here's the thing. If you're under 18, I mean, over 18, you're grown. You know you know right from wrong. You know what situation you're in. I think all that's excuses. Because I came from the gutter. I came from the streets. I came from that background. And I elevated my mindset and went. You want to elevate your mind? You got to elevate your mind. If everything else is unnecessary noise and it's excuses. So I don't give anyone excuses. When people come to me, hey, I had this issue growing up, I did too. And are you going to get to it or you going to keep crying? Because crying ain't going to do it with your t-shirt. Are you going to get to the money? Are you going to get to the bag? Are you going to get to elevating yourself in life? Or are you going to keep crying about it? What has crying ever solved for anyone? So I think all of that is excuses. And I think we should be past that point. We know who the enemy is. We know what they've done. We know what burdens we have on us as a people. Are we going to keep crying about it? Are we going to actually get up off our, and do something about it? And the best way you can do something about it is by building wealth. The higher you ascend on the wealth journey, the less complicated things get, and the more you can see, the more your eyes actually open up. And you see that everything is just a business. Slavery was a business. Mass incarceration is a business. In order for you to change that business, you have to get with that business structure and elevate from the inside out. Point blank, period. Imagine if all of us had access to wealth, how big of a conversation we can have at that table that's constricting us from everything else. So I think honestly, it's an excuse on a lot of people's end. It's an excuse to be lazy. It's an excuse for you to turn around and be nothing. It's an excuse for you to live your life like tomorrow ain't coming. That's my take on it.
Ricardo, you want to add anything before we wrap it up?
So I mean, you know, once again, I'm always excited to be on the show. I think that this is powerful for us to be able to put this sound, this frequency, this vibration, you know, in the atmosphere. It's a conversation that needs to be had. It's a conversation that should never stop, and it's a conversation that should continue. Because we are in, you know, very unique times, you know, very significant times. And, you know, people don't know what they don't know. And so, you know, we need people like Cliff. We need people like Diana. We need people, you know, that are putting, you know, systems and solutions together, you know what I'm saying, to help people get ahead. And so I think, you know, like I said before, we're living in one of the most significant time periods in history. This is the opportunity to change your life forever, create massive generational wealth for you and your family. You just have to do the right things. And like Cliff said, don't make excuses, overcome your challenges, you know, get into this space, you know, of assets, physical and digital. Learn, follow the right people. A little bit goes a long way. Like Diana said, the compound effect, you know, that snowball just, you know, rolling down the hill, and it constantly, you know, builds up. You know, that's how we all started. You know what I'm saying? We all started from nothing, you know, and we made ourselves something. And we're not, you know, no different from you per se. You know, we just made a decision and we acted on it. We went to work, you know, we got focused, you know, and we just getting started, you know. So I'm excited about the future. I think that there's a lot of negativity out there, and there's a lot of challenges, but I'm very optimistic. And I think that together, you know, we're all going to do great things. And you just want to make sure that you're in position to be an asset to the community and not a liability.
All righty. I want to thank you guys for tuning in. First of all, let me thank Cliff. We're always here the first Wednesday of every month from 12 to 1. Sharon, Cliff's topic is always, let's talk about it. And then normally I'll have Ricardo on like the third Wednesday of the month. And Ricardo's topic is normally make it make sense. So I love that. It was funny because when me and Cliff were walking out the door the last time, he said, you know, it's a lot to talk about and we should have Ricardo jump on. And I'm so glad. I really enjoyed this conversation. I feel like I'm on here talking to the people and responding to all the comments and different things like that. And they said the same thing. They said, I love seeing people of color having this conversation because we don't have a lot of people that are out here sharing and in the space. And we do find ourselves as like-minded. So again, I want to thank both of you guys. I say it all the time. I don't like them. I absolutely love getting to know them. I love their mindset. I love their character as men. Both of them are phenomenal dads. And I watch them on social media and I crack up because, you know, I know the business side of Cliff, right? But when I see him with them daughters, I'll be falling out laughing watching him on social media. And then the same thing with Ricardo. So they're not just men who are about their money. They're just about life. And I love that about the both of them. So I want to thank you guys for joining me here. We are definitely going to do this again. And I want to thank the audience for tuning in. We will see you guys next Wednesday here from 12 to 1. Thanks, Hits family. Have a great day.
Thanks for tuning in to Legacy Crypto Builders with Diana Townsend here on Hits Radio 92.3. Remember, every Wednesday from 12 noon to 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, we're here exploring revolutionary blockchains that shape our future. Continue building your knowledge and join us next week for more insights into the world of purpose-driven blockchain technology. Until then, keep innovating and shaping the future.